want to tell me you went like?
Boys.
It's
alright.
Right.
That's what he said to the vicar.
Community
stuff.
How's it going?
My brother Tony thinks he's mate. He loved George Formby. Right. Tim's going to tell you about this. So one Christmas he got a banjo ukulele. But he's having a go. But I picked it up and started like getting the rhythm. Didn't know what I was doing. Anyway, forgot about it. The next year I wanted to I love to draw and paint this art thing, right? Battery operated, and all she'd done was like square paint on this cardboard spinning round, and it made these like abstract paintings. That's all I wanted for Christmas. Yeah, but it was a paint one. So my dad come on and went, look lads, I can't get that anywhere. How about a guitar? So I just went, you know, like.
And bless his sack, right, I think it was about 12 or something, and the Jackson 5, and they had a tune looking through the windows. It was the first time I've noticed a girl, I was looking through the window, and these girls went, oh, you sound like Michael Jackson. And the first time I'd girls take notice of me, you know what I mean?
Once I got a guitar, that was it for me. Like, within 18 months, I was doing gigs in town at like 14. Nightclubs and all that, right? He was doing it himself, but he was in a chaperoned environment with other kids. I used to just go out with his brother-in-law, mates a bit older than me, and learning the craft. We learned as we went along. There's not that opportunity now, there's no venues.
He was the first person I've seen coming to school on Monday morning with a hangover.
I'm not proud of that, but...
Do you know what I mean? But like, you know, no, well, I mean, I know it's an album. But he was paying his dues, wasn't he?
Yeah.
You know, like, I was playing guitar and stuff like that, but I'm going to school and hanging around with lads. You know, like, you know, they're your peers, your contemporaries and stuff like that. But I was in this the Hilda Fallon Road show. I think it was 13 or something. And over weekends, I'd go and play social clubs. But my ma and my aunties would dress me in this like fucking silky fucking blouse and fucking and like that. And I didn't want them to know. So then, like. Oh, they found out to play guitar, but like, you know, if they ever see me dressed in what I used to wear over weekends, you know, I'd be admonished.
But I was told the teachers went to you'll amount to not in the music.
Same,
right?
Yeah. My reference.
Told the same thing.
Exactly. By the headmaster, and he got me in the corner and went, you think you're going to play the Empire? I don't know about that, sir, but I just love what I'm doing. Because my grades went down, I was considered a high flyer. Once I got a guitar, I can't wait to get out.
We went to Butlins one year. Talent competition, innit? And if you win the talent competition, you win a free holiday in Butlins. Like that. So we get to there, I thought, yeah, go on, I'll have a go with that, like that. Next thing, Gary Owie. Now, Gary Owie went to our school, he was in our year. Argus fella, cock of our year. And there's Gary Owie. I thought, oh, bastards. And he didn't know. I'm going, oh, fucking hell. So try to stay away. Like, fucking, So on the day of the talent competition, there's me ma outside the theatre with this guitar. If you don't fucking do this, I'll fucking kill you, you know what I mean? So I had to do it. And I won. So then I went back, like free holiday. You know, just me and me ma in this fucking, call it chalet, it was like fucking cellmate. Me ma, 7 days, drinking gin and telling me what to do and all that. I come fucking dead.
I remember where it was actually, second floor of St Bonaventure School, outside Miss Richmond's class, the English, that's where it was. Ah, Tony, come up, my dear, this is Digsy, he plays guitar. He's probably told you this. Said, do you know any bar chords? I went, no, I'm like, fuck off.
I met a fella called John Leggett.
I left him being a drummer in Coop the Books with us. And we had a band called Brooklyn. No, it's still, you know, your first school band, yeah. And then you go around the clubs and the pubs and stuff like that. And then Owen joins a group called Dodgers. And they were getting all gigs off Radio City, you know, like proper money gigs and stuff like that. And we were just like, so then we got bored or whatever. And we had this meeting in town in the Cardo McCaffrey. And Owen said, do you fancy amalgamating our two bands? Whereby there'd be me, Kev Kelly, John Leggett, and Owen join.
So they'd ask our keyboard player Tony to join the band, right? And he's brilliant, right? Leggett brilliant, Kevin Kelly on the guitar, and I got a bit jealous because I was getting fed up with this band. So I wangled myself in, okay? So they went, all right, maybe because I was a bit older, they let me. Maybe they didn't want me, but as it turned out good. But people used to say, things you've made it off you back there, because we're both singers, right? But I thought that was quite unique for us. You know, you don't see it that often. Bands, they only have one singer, don't they? It's very rare to have two singers. And we always shared the singer. The likes of this place, Cantle Farm, Highton Town. They just go, yeah, the Bluebell, right, wherever. Or some agents making out the game. Right, you're booked to play here, so you go, you play your heart out, maybe one or two people. You know, they've had loads of good men to come up, oh, that was great. It's afterwards, just when the manager come in then, I started, you create a mystique. Okay, then people start to go, oh, that band there. You create something. Otherwise, you're just doing the circuit. So you have to step out the circuit, right, and create something for yourself. Yeah. Whether it's true or not, but people, you know, it's just good PR. We'll buy into it.
3, 2, 1.
There was 5 of us, and we had this guitarist called Kev Kelly. Amazing guitarist, like, and so the manager takes over, whatever, and he gets rid of Kev Kelly. Now, I'm the only one playing guitar, I'm not a really guitarist, I'm buying fucking sticks. We weren't scared of him in a sense, but like, we'd stop for years and we'd go downstairs and we'd have a cup of tea. We might have a spliff or whatever. So the next thing, say the door knocks, and I'd be the manager, we'd run upstairs, get our instruments and pretend we were going through something.
It's the fucking same age, isn't it?
So there's 4 of us, there's me, Owen and John Leggett and Tony Prescott, and we had a meeting in the Copper House. Now our manager,
don't forget it's our bands we've brought him in.
So this manager had this vision, so we had this meeting one day. Now these didn't know nothing about it, so the manager goes, blah, 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 you're sacked. No, I'm just a kid, and I remember Dave's just as dumbfounded as me. I was in shock. I remember walking, you know, the field by a couple, I was walking around there, crying my fucking eyes off. Takes the end of my fucking career, goes to my bird's house, being fucked up. And the next day, they've gone, yeah, fuck off, no. You know what I mean? And that's when we started sort of, let's just concentrate on our music, you know.
Well, anyway, our manager wrote these lyrics about the toxic tribes called Pig in the Middle Eight. Our keyboard player, it was his chords, his melody and stuff. And so because it was current or whatever, it was decided we're going to do this the Probe are going to release this on the Probe Records, Jeff Davis.
And Jeff just put it through his label, distribution, rough trade, all right,
yeah, stuff like that. Yeah.
But the song trade, itself, yeah. Our manager just come in and he must have sat
listen
there and went caught between black, white, day, night. Night. Okay.
Yeah, but picking him out, Liverpool late. Pigs. You know, it was
Piggy, right. I'm quite clever, but you know when I look back I go, yeah, they're a bit fifth form to me. A two-bar riff all the way through the song. That's all there is. But we all wrote it, but they copied it for themselves, which I get a bit resentful over again. Because Tony go right in the chorus, we go to this key change. I'm going, no, fucking simplify it, simplify. Yeah. He sorted the chords out, the melody, and they'll come up with the bass line.
Leggy?
Yeah.
Fuck off.
Fucking John Leggy. I got the first part. I don't know what to do. And he went,
did he?
Did he?
Yeah.
That's not right. Bad.
I think only British bands can say this. You know, being on the dole, they fucking helped. They helped loads of famous bands. I mean, but by being on the dole, you know, you could actually, you know, get your jar out, but you could also concentrate on your art and well, you could stay in a band.
So you could still develop.
I don't get it. That's his years, right?
Yeah,
so in a way, she was buying into the whole socialist thing.
So our next three singles are going to be on Probe Records. Low Profile is one of my fucking favourite songs.
We got signed, right, in the 80s, nearly £1 million, right? We were on £40 a week enterprise allowance. Believe it or not, he put us in for that, right or wrong?
Aye.
Right, next thing, we're still living, like, with our mas. I've got a kid, right, she's only a baby, I'm living in a flat in Haven Road. Next thing, he's got all these workers working on this house in Tubby, fucking lovely, all sweet and all that. When we got signed to Virgin, once they got hold of us, right, it just started collapsing in itself, it was becoming, they had the wrong producers for us, right.
So from making our own records and stuff, all of a sudden, we got signed, and there's a fella called Gus Dudgeon, a producer, he's dead now, but we're kids, so if they mention someone's famous name, we go, and he's working with such and such, oh yeah, we'll go with him. Now, regardless of like not even listening to his work, we know we're going to the studio blind. We don't know. All we know is the song. You make it a hit. Do you know what I mean?
Virgin. You know, the A&R fellas see your band in a different way, and they give them a brief, right? But whatever they say, go with it a bit. But this is what we want, and you start getting on the politics. What's
so
going on?
Away your song, aren't they?
To make it like we want to go with this market.
So they play us. I mean, he'd write a song and I'd fuck around some Versace or whatever. So next thing we're in London or whatever. So the end product, he'd listen and go, what's that? But we have no say in the matter by then because we've become part of the machine.
But our best recordings were always done.
Peel sessions,
live, basically live. Maybe the vocals done a bit later, but just live, you know what I mean? Then if you want to add and try stuff out, when you get into like where it's like £2,000 a day in the 80s for a studio, Okay.
Danny, it's fucking boosters, mate.
And then the keyboard player, Tony's going here, can I try the latest synth house? Tony, you haven't used it, you don't know what works.
Only hire company, and it'd be there, if you asked for anything, it'd be there
so
for you.
So, what does that mean? And then you'd be there 2 days, and all she's doing is just going, and you go, fucking hell. Or try this guitar part out, Golden Age, one of the best guitar parts ever, right? Just sometimes, you know, yo, that's fucking brilliant, right? Then you'd have a gig where you go, how shit was that? Then everyone's coming up going, that was the best gig ever.
I tell you what, you're going, yeah, I've got, yeah.
Then you go, we come off and go, what, the best gig ever? And then people would go, oh, that wasn't good, that. See, how, there's a thing there.
Perceptions, isn't
there? Mine was, sometimes, like, say the manager wasn't there, say the manager was away on a meeting, or, you know, I like, fucking, I'd love them because we play gigs, whether in Europe or America or wherever, like that. And after the gig, we'd sit in the dressing room and we'd wait for the manager to come in to tell us whether we'd done a good gig or not. Do you know what I mean? John Armstrong, they loved us, so they went, look, come to America with us.
Moving in the right direction, living just enough, just enough.
Run on the stage with the bass, ladies and gentlemen, all the way from Liverpool. Coop the boots, run on the stage, I've been pissing down. I just went fuck off with the bass. And all you could hear was on the PA was and I'm like,
best echoes I've ever made.
And then they're
best live albums ever.
They're just looking at me going, fucking got. That was one of the worst gigs.
Let's do the first month in a fucking car, mate.
See, an Oldsmobile it was.
We're not driving here from Manchester. America's massive. So, like, one night we'd be doing 300 miles in a car. Sometimes 500, sometimes 600, sometimes. And it, you know, it's proper intense.
One, 900 miles.
In a car.
From gig.
In the back of a fucking car. So then Detroit, we're playing Detroit. Now what, after every show, Joe and I'm trading his crew, they take our equipment, so we just bail on the car, see you there, we load up on drugs and just fucking hit the highway. So we hit Detroit, now we're on, it's supposed to be on 8 o'clock, whatever. Gets to Detroit, now can we fuck find a venue? And our manager is bonkers. So at these lights, next thing our manager goes, ah, fuck this, fuck off, right onto the pavements, fuck off, right past the lights. Next thing behind us, car goes, fuck off, twats us. My dad and go, next thing, Jesus, get out. No, we know.
It's America.
You know, I'm like, hey, man, you're fucking...
Can you carry your gun, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And these fellas, and our man's got the sunglasses on, and he's very tall, by the way, looks very intimidating, and he's not fucking budging. He goes, look, theatre, we're going there, yeah, see you later.
Nah, it takes me shit ourselves. He's shit.
Shit. Well, anyway, fucking... So,
that's a fact, I'm telling you. So I remember it, clearly.
So do you know where, like that, so we get to the theatre, now get on this. We pulled into the car park. Now, all John Armand trainers, road crew, they've set our gear up. We have got to get out the car, fucking like that, and just fuck off for two on stage.
Yeah.
Now, think about it. I'm going to kill me. Yeah. I'm going to have to do this fucking, you know. Yeah. So, I does the gig. So then, who turns up? The geezers, the fellas. Now, the road crew, Charlie, it was Thin Lizzy's fucking, anyway, you know that. So they all turn up like that. So the next thing, soft ass here, gets a bit above himself. Oh yeah, you're not talking like that anymore, are you, lad?
I didn't.
Yeah, you was.
And I didn't. And I went, why don't you get in the boot now, mate? And his mate's shit themselves. Because I had to relax and all that. And I went, fucking kick your ass now, don't you? What fucking money up? Get in the fucking boot
I'm
now.
20 years
and then
age.
They went, like oh, hang on a minute. Hang on a minute. I'm telling you.
Now our single's about to come out in England, isn't it? Now we're away. I mean, looking back now, it's pretty common sense. We're in America, like that. Our single comes out in Britain. We're not there even to promote it. Now, that is bad mismanagement, that.
We've done the tour for 2-3 months, America. It's time to come home. And I went, look, we're best staying here now. You know, like the police song, and just play fucking the little venues now and build up a following. And again, John Smith, no, we're going on.
So, like, they released one more record on Virgin, and then basically that was it then. And then once the money goes, mate, it's like...
We didn't have the money in the first place.
Well, we had our own
we
studios.
We were £40.
Yeah, but...
Fucking
but
on the enterprise allowance. How fucking mad's that? And everyone else, it was working with Pete Burns, who were fucking... Basically, it was Pete Burns' band. They were on, like, £200 a week in the 80s.
So it was like, all right, it's the end of the band. No, it's 1987, isn't it?
We were making our best music. Honest to God, we were.
But it's 87 or whatever, and then, now fuck this. So I don't hang around with musicians. I don't even fucking see them now. I hang around with these fucking gangsters, these drug dealers. And then 88, ecstasy comes in, doesn't it? And it's a whole different climate of music. And it was like, fuck guitars. You know, you sit next to you go, fuck off. Now he hadn't. I was like, fucking, that's the future if you like, or whatever.
But the 80s, when catchers started decimating, especially the working class areas, the strongholds, labour, you know, yeah, jobs and stuff like that. My dad, most of the family worked in Tyne Lars, they got an incentive to move production to London, even though they were on the Mersey. Now they realised it was the worst decision they ever made. Not only that, all the kids are getting on the smack because the streets were flooded with smack. There was no jobs, no prospects for anyone. And that's why we're still seeing the aftermath of it, you know what I mean? Generations who've never worked, never done nothing, you know what I mean? Because that's what they were told. So this song, Half an Hour, is like some kid who wakes up in the morning, he's going to do the fucking same thing again, go looking for work, right? And he'll just get fucked off, right? And basically, half an hour is just give me half an hour and I'll show you that I'm a good worker. Give me a chance. Basically, that's all to say. So to know to where Tatcher's here, a fucking sad one, but I believe the most simplest song I've ever wrote and the quickest. I just got it in the middle of the night, right, because it was going through my head. I penciled in the day. You know, I don't speak like that, but there's an artistic thing in it. Right, and within fucking 20 minutes, I had the song down, went to bed, fucking went fast asleep, went in the next day. And we used to do it live, didn't we?
We certainly fucking did, but get on this, viewers. I didn't know until about a month ago what the actual song, you know, when you explained to a stranger what the song was about, and it made sense then. And I've known this song for fucking...
C minor,
G
minor, I don't know. Penciled in the day, never so sure on my feet, but just to away without a mission takes the place of defeat. From a start to a finish, I'd work like a dog on a bone. Hard to my heels are the engines, they're slowly fading out. And all the men who love them, even though they broke their backs, calling for forgiveness, but the clock keeps up into ten. I walk around in circles, I hope just to find me a crack, some crack. Give me half an hour, let me feel just what it's like. One step away from the heat. One step away from the heat. I'm only one step away from the heat. One step away from the heat. Question what to say, but the clock keeps up into ten.
He went, I tried still to create music. Myself, I just went, I need to earn the living. I want to earn the living. Right, I've got to fucking sing that song, sing the other. He carries on with it. I didn't. I just went, I need the money. I've got to fucking pay the rent. I've got to fucking make sure my kids have got the nice fucking gear on.
And you never actually fucking scruffiest kids in the world.
Have you seen them? I've seen fucking better clubber on Oliver.
Fucking rags to riches, you haven't fucking left!
I could, it's gonna kill you.
So?
Charlie. I love Charlie, but I went to see some of his work here last year at the Tate. And instead of having the rope, you could actually go up and see the brush strokes. And when I seen it in real life, I wasn't that impressed with it. I like the copies of his prints. There's something, there's something in the original that when they copy it, because it's a block colour, and you can't get the detail of the brush strokes, it flattens the image and it's a lot more surreal again. But when you see, I went, oh my God, isn't that strange? And the same Picasso, not a big Picasso fan, but to go up and see his brush strokes, you know, that way, you know, the brush that big and then swirl that way, you know, it's just fascinating. Lichtenstein, Roy Lichtenstein, I think he is absolutely brilliant with the Bende dots. You know, the printing technique, again, what you use from comics. It wasn't block colour, it was pin printed. So he does his, know the kiss, like comics, strong, bold outlines, but all the colour is done in dots. Right? I think his work's absolutely brilliant.
At the back is a gang of two brushes loitering with intent. Look at them. Look at them. Yeah, with back up. Called Toothpaste. Now apparently this is the leader of the gang. Oh, alright mate, yeah, alright. What's your agenda? What do you mean? I said, what's your agenda? Alright mate, you know, calm down, fucking hell.
Smokey Robinson. If you listen to his words, they're so fucking simple that, like, you go, Christopher had the real people, he has a knack for that. You know, he sing a line, you go, it sounds so simple, but, like, it doesn't come to you. Bob Dylan said about Smokey Robinson, he's one of the best poets I've ever heard, because it's the simplicity of the actual words that won't come to you, you know what I mean? Your record comes out, so sometimes you'll sit with your mates playing your own records. I mean, my mate here sitting at the side of me, he's told me more of what my lyrics mean than what I actually thought it did. Because it's other people's expectations of what they think it is, do you know what I mean?
Go on, lads.
But I'm not the only one.
You're on camera.
I hope someday you will
join us.
And the world will live as one.
What's your name, lad?
McIntyre.
Hi, McIntyre.
Possessions. Nice to meet you.
And you as well. Don't mind me filming you.
No, I don't. I wonder if you can. You look like Digsy.
Books. I collect a lot of sheet music and songbooks. Biographies. I love biographies. One of my favourites. It's very honest. Very funny and very eloquently written is David Niven's The Moon's a Balloon. Absolutely. There's two volumes, I can't remember what the other one's called now, but I read the two of them. And, you know, that man's life, and he pulled no punches, he just told how it was, who he hated, why he hated them, why they hated him, you know, directors and stuff like that. And fiction, stuff like that, never bothered me. I liked sheet music, art books and stuff like that. Until a few years ago, I was in Cuba and I'd, what book has been, Nina Simone's life story. I'd finished that. I picked this book up, Sacred, I wonder what's that. And the first line was, never walk down my, round my neighborhood in a pink shirt, because you're asking for trouble. I went, whoa. I was a fella called Dennis Lehane. Started the book, couldn't put it down. But was that made up, I read it again. All-time favorites, The Grapes of Wrath. Again, still relevant. You know, went out a bit because of, like, everyone's, you know, welfare, you know, didn't work, they're getting looked after. The way things are going now, basically, it's the Tebbit syndrome. Get on your bike and go somewhere else. Be aware, you know.
I mean, I look at him now, like, you know, him and his birds. You know, we live in exactly wherever. You know, he does voluntary work, he does fucking everything on his bed. You know, just, you know, for the community. All you can do is help people around you. And he does that. Not bad.
Oh, that's, I can't believe it, you said that.
Sometimes I go, yeah, come on, fucking, I haven't wrote a new song for fucking few months here. And you'll get your guitar, you'll make sure everyone's out the house, or you know, you'll put yourself in, you know, into that moment, and you'll try, and nothing will come there. Inspiration just won't come knocking, you go, ah, fucking bastard. Then you get on the bus, the next thing, melody will just come, you go, oh, fucking hell. And so then, next thing, you can't talk to anyone. Oh, we can get home. It's like, oh, yeah, it sounds fucking great there. And you'll get off the bus, get into the house, and fucking Rosie and Jim will be on or something, and it's gone.
Well, good afternoon, and welcome to Who's on the Couch? Well, today on our couch, we will be talking to the literary, gorgeous little ginger nut that is Sienna Rendell. Ah, Miss Rendell. You are a very famous novelist and a literary genius. Would you like to explain some of your work? What? What'd you say? Oh, yeah, I can see where you're coming from on that one.
I had to go see the school, I chose the school, and the teacher's like, yeah, so goes back and says, yeah, no, yeah, what's going on there? Why don't my school? And he goes, Dad, I can't wait till playtime. I thought, fuck off. Do you want to hear it? I'll just give you the chorus there. Fucking, there's loads of things that people say, and you just go, oh, fucking.
First memory of a film for me is Mighty Joe Young. Right, stop start animation, you know, like a friendly King Kong. That's me first. And then going to pictures to see The Wizard of Oz. But that was, when I think about it, it was on the pictures by Clayton Square. The Wizard of Oz, going to see that there. But it was 30 years after it was released then. Do you know what I mean? So it just shows how popular it still was. A lot of stuff by Ray Harryhausen. Sinbad, Jason and the Argonauts. I mean, I just think that man is an artist. Cowboy films, I love cowboy films, and I love gangster films. Cagney, James Cagney, there's no one better. We have a film club here once a month, and most of the films are Liverpool-based, okay? Liverpool actors, you know. So, Public Enemy starts, do you know what? It could be, as they say, not a screen crocky today. Nothing's changed. Nothing's changed. You know, there was kids with guns then, right? And I suppose there always has been. And that film, you know, as dated as it looks, the message is still the same. You know what I mean? It's just that the violence is just like, you know, I'm shot. You know, it's not like bang, you know, blood and gore, but still conveys the same message.
My brother was in a band called Worlds Apart or something like that. Like, this is about, this is 1990. Now I'd left Coote Brookes had disbanded between 87. So for 3 years, my daughter was born in 87. So for 3 years, I was just in the wilderness and just knocking around with fucking drug dealers and all my mates and whatever, you know, and just going to raves. And then I thought, oh my God, yeah. So in the end, they're looking for a singer. It's a lot like Noel Gallagher's fucking thing as well. You know, so I comes in, call them small. And then Noel started playing and stuff like that. And it was around the time we met Noel Gallagher and stuff. And like, just, you know, playing our own tunes. They were fucking rubbish. Oasis and us, by the way. Do you know what I mean? It's like, you've got to find your fucking ground. And And until someone really actually believes in you, you go, hang on, you've got something there. It's like they went to Scotland to support some shitty fucking bands. McGee's there, right place, right time. Yeah. You know what I mean? And until someone goes, hang on, you've got something there. And then you think, oh, someone believes in you. And then that's when you go, oh, yes.
As a kid, I was fascinated with Cuba. Maybe it was the word Cuba, you know. I've no idea. I always wanted to go. Liked what he'd done with the Americans, you know, Castro, you know, Che Guevara, Raul, De Figaro. He died in a car crash in 65, I think. You know, all these great men standing up against, like, an oppressive regime just wanted to take over the place. So 5 years ago, lucky enough, booked a holiday, and I've never seen that. I've travelled the world, I've literally travelled the world, but never been on a proper holiday. So Cuba, and I just walked out on that beach, the Caribbean Sea, the colour, and everything what pressured me just went, the palm trees, the people. So we've been going back for the last 5 years, but it's changing a lot now. It's got to adapt.
That's how I pictured England, with like fucking nuclear weapons for the Yanks and all that.
Is so that right?
England may as well be Cuba. Yeah. So, you know, that's what it is.
But, Frankie, Hank Williams, imagine Hank Williams singing this. And it's wrote in that style. Ooh.
Jumps on the mainframe. It all
Lights to me was, you know, your first record, your first single, you know what I mean? Fucking stage doors and moon bags and stuff. And then they buy us a van, they book you a tour, and then your record's getting played everywhere and it's in all the shops, and you'll go to a city that you've never been before. Look out, and there's kids there that you're recording, they're singing along to your fucking words, mate. That's the whole point about being in the bands. You can stick every drink and drug up your ass. Just being in a place you've never met anyone in your life, these kids, and they're fucking singing along to your tunes. There's a connection, lad. That's what music's about. The lowest part is when all the money's run out, and it's like, listen, I've got no more money. Like, we recorded our second album, you know, we put our heart and soul to the second album. It's not going to get released. It's all put on the shelf, and that's it, back on the dole. Once there was no more money, and like that, so all my band left me. Like that, they basically got a job in Cadbury's, the guitarist, he fucking got a job in a hairdresser's shop or something nasty, and fucked off and left me. It was like rats leaving a stinking ship, or twats leaving a fucking... Anyway, regardless. So that's gone, but then, I know Chris Mullin now, he was in the Sums, he was around at that time. So my mate, Paul Bowness, yeah, he was in a band, but his band was splitting up. It was above a snooker room. He went, yeah, Digsy, come on. So, like, me and Chris just stopped, wrote a load of new songs, and the Sums just came about, like, I don't even like the fucking name, actually. But then it just stands for Some Unusual Man Singing.
Photography, I mean, again, you look at a snap of, like, you, your mind, and dad at a certain point, right? And rather than watching a video, that one image can convey so much more than a holiday video, I believe. You know what I mean? It's there, it's frozen. Reading, National Geographic in school, the photographs are like Aborigine tribes, you know, beautiful. You know, the colours on them, the blues, or in the rainforest, or Eskimos, you know. All the kids would be reading the Dandy and the Beano. I'd go for them, you know. Not read the story, just look at the photographs, you know, the colours and everything. And during touring in the 80s, I had a little Olympus trip. Use some Ektachrome film, get some slides. But I didn't know what I was doing. I'd just, like, mess with it. And lucky, most of the stuff turned out all right. Two months ago, I got myself only an entry level, an SLR digital camera, and I've been taking a lot of photographs, family stuff, abstract stuff, just life, portraits, and just messing with the lighting, stuff like that, the angles, you know, contrasting one subject with another. A lot of graffiti. I took a lot of graffiti photographs in Cuba. A lot of Cuba's a free country, you know, in Spanish and stuff like that. And there's one bar, you can go in, right, I think it's, you know, 20 odd years, and you can sign your name and leave a message, and the whole place but looks beautiful. A lot of political stuff, a lot of fun stuff, a lot of people in love. Just, we've come on our honeymoon here, you know, in English, Argentinian, you know, Canadians, French, a lot of Russians there. So it's great to see all these personal messages, right? What you don't understand, but they're conveying something. For someone to take the time to do that, and it's allowed to do, you know, this unity, you know, with this graffiti, it's fascinating. Look at the love. The love in that, the safety in that. I mean, with me just becoming a grandfather as well, you know, it makes it more poignant, you know what I mean? But the definition, the colour. You know, this is that be all and end all till it gets to a certain age. See, he sat there for ages waiting for that to look away, so the light filtered. And that's the thing about photography, all these, they've sat there for hours, maybe weeks even, just sitting there waiting for the right moment. You know, a lot of time and money spent to get one shot, but that's the price. It's well worth it. I mean, does that know that's him? You know, does he know he's looking at himself? I'm disappointed they haven't used, like, what type of camera, or if they've used any filters, shutter speed settings and stuff like that. I thought that might have been interesting for people like me who are learning, you know, so you could take notes and try and copy the shots, you know what I mean?
My contemporaries, if you like, when I say contemporaries, they're my age and they've sold more records than me. Shall I name them?
Yeah, cool.
McNabb, Ian Prowse and fucking Peter Luton, Pete Wiley, and they're all egotistical fucking, you know what I mean? It's like, they can't, Frank Mosley, Flock of Seagulls. You know, I mean, all these people who were more famous than me and Owen in the 80s. But to see them now, me and Owen are quite fucking proud of our work. I mean, we're not asked about fucking doing a Kid the Boots fucking reunion or whatever for money or whatever. We don't care. But when I see these people, they still try to hang on, clinging on to what was. And I think that's fucking hilarious to me, mate, you know what I mean? I think it's fucking just, it's beautiful and it's also pathetic. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, just be proud of your records, mate. Go on, just get on with your fucking life, for fuck's sake. If only, they're just, they're old songs, do you know what I mean? That's just like a taste of me, you know? This next one is the most important of the Sun's records, like. Expecting or hoping, if we can sell enough copies, if only, for us to go back into the studio to record the next album. And then to sell enough copies of the next album to do the next one. You're only as good as your last song, you know, and just carry on writing, carry on writing. I played the Empire and stuff in town or whatever, but like, I mean, the songs are pick. You know, it's like, you have to pay tribute to the tune, man, you know what I mean? You know, you don't just go fucking, you know, it's not karaoke fucking shit, you know what I mean? You put your own self into it and whatever. And yeah, I would say, yeah, I do get a little bit of enjoyment out of it. The only reason I have to do this is to support my family, you know what I mean? You know, it's just, it pays the bills.
We are not too busy at the minute, but we'll be later. We've got our Janet here, our Brian, these are locals.
Okay,
Yeah, that's in Korean. But did you support live music
drop there, which is really good?
Because it's all time off now. You know, like,
and this is a guitar.
At first, it did bother me when I first started doing it. I went, I'm selling out here, you know what I mean? It's all over. But I went, no, hang on. This is what I've always done. I've done it before, right? Learning, right? Doing covers, you know, quote stuff and all that, what, you know, with my mates at 13, 14, 15. And then you go, you creative period, still creative, still writing now, you know, but you gotta earn some money, right? And you can't go out doing that. But it pays the bills, you know. And you still have to give 110% and not be ashamed. I know some guys, you know, they just hate themselves for doing it. Well, if you're hating yourself and you're performing, that's going to come across. The audience will pick up on this by your demeanour, you know, by the way you're interacting in between and all that. There's no shame in it. There is no shame. Unless you're doing agadoo, you know, you're fucked then.
I'll tell you what, I made up that Jen's not working tonight, can't stand it.
I remember going over Oral Park Bridge with my guitar and my little fucking silk suit, crossing Oral Park Bridge like, and thinking, this is what I want to do. I want to do this for the rest of my life, you know what I mean? If I thought for one moment, oh, that's it, Diggs, come on, that's it. I'm concentrating on just doing covers and fucking, you know, I live in a council house, like, if I thought for one moment that I wouldn't carry on, you know what I mean? I do actually believe that, like, fucking, yeah, you know, my chance will come.
In my little head, lad, you know what I mean? There was me and him and John Leggett and Tony Prescott. Regardless of John Smith or even the record company, you think, you know, like, say, you've wrote a boss tune and you've recorded something and you go, fuck, oh, man, that's so good. And you think in your head, we're going to be together for the rest of our lives. It's not a pipe dream, because to us it was a proper dream, you know what I mean? But like, once it happens, and, you know, I mean, shit happens, whatever. But look, I end up like fucking, he's got two kids there, I fucking love them. I've got three kids, he loves them. And to see our families gel or whatever and just go, like on Thursday when he's become a granddad, sitting there going, you can't beat that bar. And that's what it's about, family, I suppose. We're being blessed with the same, our birds, we've been with the same birds, right? We've been
spot on.
Our girlfriends, right? We're there, we've been having a pot of piss in, right through the whole fucking gamut of all this fucking whatever, and they're still there for us. So we're lucky in the sense of, like, if we weren't doing anything, they would go out to work, and they still do, by the way. Do you know what I mean?
All said and done. All said and done. Right.
Is that I'm better than you?
We didn't do it for fame. Just, if we could affect ourselves by our own music, then someone else is going to be affected. Hell, fuck that.
Me and him soon, we're back to that place that we were there years ago.
If it takes a lifetime, right, just like them fucking 3 minutes of magic, you know, I'm willing to just give me life to that, you know what I mean? And that's all it's about, like, you know.
Song about him, actually. He got a bit lost. No, it's all about, no, the drum machines and all that, he was in a haze and all that, and I fucking missed him so much.
to go for it, but you won't turn me down. Just take a message to the other man, the one who's down. He sits in silence with a vacant stare. He watches all this, he doesn't care. You're my only prayer.
Always there like that. Like, there come a point where it went like that. But you know what? Not if I fucking needed him or he needed me. It would, seriously, fucking murders I've had with him. Not with the stupid things and vice versa, you fucking bastards. But you know what? No sense. That sounds fucking sweet, corny. But we are there for each other. Because I know.
And he knocks it out, and I'll send his ass to borrow money for his ciggies and all that, you know what I mean? Can't get a fucking living, mate, you know what I mean? Digsy, don't tell Angie that I borrowed money off you.
Switch that off!
Tennis
on fucking Wednesday.